as you approach.
Well, my human friend, the stars don't speak as you or I speak, but I've found that if you listen to something hard enough for long enough, you can understand what it's saying to you.
But not the actual stars.
What?
Or specific stars.
Not specific stars. It's more, everything has a place in the cosmos.
So if I had a question for a specific star, you wouldn't be able to answer it.
Which star do you have a question for?
And Red will do his best to astronomically describe the red star that is central to his religion.
And what's the question you have for it?
Does this star have a name?
No, it's just the red star.
And it wouldn't matter anyway because Wendy has no training in astrology.
Religion. And what's the question you have for it?
Well, I suppose my question is, what next? The star will know. The star will understand that.
And Wendy just looks perplexed for a moment because she's trying to read Red's facial expressions to figure out what he actually wants her to say, and she can't.
He kind of doesn't have a face.
Right. Yeah, Red has no facial expressions, so.
The stars are telling me that if you devote your life to helping others, then good fortune will come to you as well.
Yeah, I mean, that's what I got from it, too. I just was hoping for something slightly more specific.
Oh, well, I'm sorry, but that sort of long-distance message. I only get 25 words or less.
Huh. Raazu.
Red seems to be counting in his head.
Wow.
Awesome. Raazu.
Hey.
As you enter the commons, it's a kind of a large open room where you see wooden benches or tables or anything can be laid out. Right now, they're all kind of shoved aside to one edge of the room, and some doors, some wooden doors in the back of the room stand open, and you have this very earthy odor that's coming up from below. And what's happening right now is you hear this sloshing sound, and you can see on the other side of the door, there are stairs heading down to a cellar, and they're essentially going down with buckets and bailing out the cellar. The person kind of directing this task, they weren't lying about this hearth either. I mean, halflings know how to do a hearth right. There is a huge stone hearth that takes up almost an entire edge of this commons area with something boiling away in a large kettle or a large pot in one edge of it. And another edge you see where they have kind of a scrawny looking lamb that's been recently slaughtered and skinned that's kind of roasting for the evening meal. The person directing this labor is an elderly halfling man who's gravely stooped over. He has this enormous hunch on his back, and he's wearing a long black cloak, directing back and forth. This is the man you were told to come in and kind of report to.
I'll walk up to him and say, "Heard that there was work need doing up here. I was hoping I'd trade that for lodgings for the night." Raazu looks at the cellar and she says, "I think I might have an idea of what needs doing."
You don't know shit about Osprey yet.
No.
The man turns around. You kind of startled him. And he has this beautiful, like very well-tended, curly handlebar mustache on his face. Mm-hmm. And one of his legs clomps against the ground. You see, he's holding a cane, leaning very heavily on it. And you can see one of his legs has been amputated and just replaced with a wooden peg. Mm-hmm. And at first, he kind of stares startled into your crotch, because that's all the taller he is, and then scans upward. He has to kind of lean back, and you see this is causing him some difficulty because of his hunch. And he says that it's been many years. Actually, he picks up his cane and kind of waves it in the air a little bit. Says it's been many years since he's seen a hobgoblin this close in person. And the last time he did, they didn't live to tell about it. He says it very threateningly. This 80-year-old halfling with a hunchback and a peg leg.
Raazu nods curtly and says, "I'm just passing through. I'm just looking for lodging. I'm willing to work for it."
And he peers over at the lamb that they have on the spit. "I'll bet you can eat that whole thing yourself, big gal like you." And he leans forward and claps the side of your hips with his cane.
Raazu takes it in stride. She looks over it and cocks her head. And says, "You know, I don't know if that was, is that all. Is that all you have? Is that all you have cooking here?" Because what Raazu's thinking is like that one lamb. I don't know if it's gonna feed the entirety of this village.
Oh, probably it's not intended to. Each of these little households will have their own. Will feed their own. Oh. This is
okay.
But he, you know, he does bristle a little bit at the comment, and he tells you that as kind of a, you can tell it's almost a point of pride. Like, you know, don't you worry, we'll get your belly filled if you're willing to. Essentially, he wants you to grab a bucket and get bailing. But no sooner is a bucket thrust into your hands than a couple of these little border soldiers come in. And one of them saying, "I think we should hold his toes over a spit." The other one says, "I think we should dunk his head in the well." And they're going back and forth and back and forth. And the old elder catches wind of this. And as you're bailing water, you overhear their conversation about this kobold that they grabbed recently and about how kobolds are never seen this far south in the foothills unless there's a big problem coming. And they need to find out what. And then the elder has this great idea. And he says, "You, Hobbo." And you're wearing your arms and I mean you're full armor, chainmail and everything, right? Are you wearing colors at all?
No.
He asks you if you have any experience with prisoners of war.
Raazu bristles a little bit, but nods slowly.
He says, "It seems that we have such a prisoner on our hand. And none of my men want to tackle the situation in an appropriate manner."
Who are you at war with?
And he tells you, "Hopefully nobody. But if there are kobolds on their borders..." And he explains a little bit about the Ten Salts kobolds that live up in the hills. Large armies of them. And they tend not to come down into the lowlands very often. But when they do, they come in great force. And what he needs you to do, and this will earn you an entire lab and a mug of ale besides, is to go down and interrogate this prisoner and figure out what he's doing, what they're planning, and then what should be done with him.
Very well.
And he elbows one of the lads and he says, "She won't have any trouble dunking his head in the well." Birdie.
Yep.
Eventually, you hear a loud knock back and a voice from above say, "All right, enough racket in there." And Raazu, they do take you. You're shown down to the storeroom area down here where their stores do seem to be dwindling quite a bit. And there's a cellar door in the back. And they pull this rug aside and they drag the iron or drag the wooden plank out of the way. And inside of the room is just this hellacious banging and crying noise. This just pitiful whimpering. And you're there with two of these halfling soldiers.
I don't know, that's slanderous.
Raazu lets the halflings pull this kobold out.
Oh, they don't. They pull the plank out of the way and leave you to it.
Raazu decided, okay, and then Raazu pulls the door open, looks down inside.
And Birdie, you're looking up at their pet. Apparently these halflings have a pet hobgoblin that they've just unleashed on you.
No. I immediately bolt. Try to go around.
All right, let's roll initiative. My halflings go on 3.
So it's just...
There we go! There's Razu's patented initiative roll.
Birdie escapes and Raazu thinks to herself, "I'm never gonna let this happen again."
Never. This is how she learned Sentinel right here.
uh...
But I imagine it's not a very big space, and Raazu wouldn't allow Birdie to run past her.
I mean, these are about 5 foot squares. So the space isn't very big. The difficulty is coming from up below in the cellar. This is an almost completely flooded cellar, and he was only on one or two stone stairs the whole time. So yeah, who
won? He's also manacled, yeah?
No, they took the manacles off when they threw him down there.
Oh, okay. Then never mind.
So yeah, Birdie, you're up first.
I mean,
you've got to go through Razu's threat range to do that.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay, so
I'm gonna try to grapple the kobold.
All right, so that's gonna be strength athletics for both of you. Birdie's really good at these.
Well, Birdie wins. Birdie wins.
Is that
that's why he's part team rogue?
Is that the sound Birdie's making as he runs out?
Yeah.
And both of the halflings also try to grapple you. I've got a 16 on one.
A
15.
Yeah.
Okay. So yeah, the first of the halflings is you're trying to bolt for the door in daylight. Reaches out with his arm and gives you a clout across the face. Kind of gets you in a headlock from which you don't slip free.
Birdie's kicking like, no.
And that's... I guess you still have your action, Birdie.
I mean, I'm not going to attack anybody.
Okay. That's going to bring us to Raazu.
Well, I guess my action would be to try to break the grapple.
Okay.
Three, you are.
So that would be like a 5 total.
Yeah, 5's not going to cut it. And Raazu, you're up.
Maybe either of these halflings have manacles handy?
Not to hand anymore, no.
Oh.
One of them kind of says, careful with these, they're slipperier than you probably expect.
Raazu grabs Birdie by the collar of his shirt and checks him into the wall of the structure.
And both of the halflings go, ooh!
Birdie's just like pinned to the wall and he's just kicking and scratching.
And the two halflings leave the room and the door closes. And now, Birdie, you're alone with their pet hobgoblin.
Birdie just goes limp and plays dead.
Raazu shakes him a little bit.
He's like squeezing his eyes shut, but just not moving.
Kobold, you're going to tell me where you're from, what you're doing here, or those halflings out there are going to make mincemeat of you.
Birdie is just like, he's shaking, but he's still got his eyes closed.
If you don't tell me anything, then if you tell me nothing, I'll be forced to tell them nothing. And I don't know what they're going to do with you, but it's probably not going to be pleasant.
Birdie opens his eyes and looks at Raazu and says, they already put me in manacles and threw me in a water sex dungeon.
Raazu cocks her brow, looks down at the cellar door like...
If this is a sex dungeon, these halflings don't know anything about sex.
Yeah. Well...
Birdie's just using words he doesn't understand.
Be that as it may, what are you doing here?
What am I doing here in this village?
What were you trespassing here? What happened?
No, I was walking down the road when a bunch of little short warty dudes jumped me and tied me up and threw me on the back of a dog and rode me into town, talking about they were going to torture me.
Why'd they do it?
I don't know. Ask them.
Where are you from? You're not from the Dragon Horse to the north?
No, I'm from the south. No, wait, that'd be southeast, right? Because we're like way up.
Yeah, we're way
from the
west.
Southeast. I'm from the southeast.
So you're not one of Qiang Zhao is not your sire?
No.
Who is your sire then?
This is where we find out if Birdie actually recorded the name of his sire.
I don't have it.
Mm-hmm.
I think I remember it too, but I want to see him twist in the wind a little bit.
That would be fantastic if you actually knew it and he didn't.
It's a secret.
Out of character, it's Keel Breath, right?
Yeah, it actually is. Keel Beer.
Boom.
Yeah. My brain just kept coming back with Qiang Zhang. I'm like, that's not right.
Raazu says, I heard... Go ahead.
I was just saying, my sire is... not... And he just kind of falters.
Your sire's not what? Raazu pushes him against the wall again?
Just shaking the kobold. He's like, don't shake the kobold!
They expect a show. I have to make some kind of noise, but I don't. I'm not inclined to hit some. I'm not inclined to hurt something so pathetic. There's no honor in it.
So great point. Does Raazu change her mind about this, or?
Raazu's just trying to press him for information right now.
I mean. He's from the south. Birdie's like, I'm from the southeast. I was just minding my own business, and I was viciously attacked.
Do you have any proof of where you come from?
Do you? Like, is that something you just carry around with you?
Raazu kind of thinks for a minute. Says, fair point, little one. What's your name?
Hey, Birdie.
This is where he gives a fake name, and then it's just really awkward for the next 3 years.
We already did that.
Birdie.
My mother was just really hoping that I was an Urd. And I disappointed her every day of my existence.
All right. Well.
But she's dead now, so it's okay.
Wow. Cavalier. Yeah, Raazu does say that. It's like, wow, that's kind of a cavalier attitude to look at it.
Birdie looks at the giant hobgoblin with a very flat stare and says, I mean, everybody's dead.
Everyone. I mean, that's not too far off from where I'm coming from.
Can you put me down, please?
Raazu takes him back over to the cellar door. Says, are you going to make trouble, tunneler?
I don't have any... I took my shovel. I love that shovel. I hope it never gets destroyed.
The kobold spends the next 6 hours explaining how important this shovel is to him.
Raazu goes to put him back down in the cellar.
No, 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 no. It's wet down there.
Here's the thing, though, is they're not going to let me just take you out on a leash.
Do you have a leash?
I sure don't.
Oh, well, then that's a terrible idea. Why would you bring that up?
There's a convenient lead hanging nearby that they might use for livestock. Just on a hook on the wall.
Listen, Listen, I grew up in a swamp, okay? And I don't like... Like, it was terrible. It was terrible. Just, it was terrible. Don't put me back down there.
I'll do what I can to get to at least get you out of there.
Can you at least just, I don't know, leave me up here where it's dry?
Sorry, but
Birdie gives him Birdie gives the biggest puppy dog cobalt eyes he can.
I'm in probably just as much hot water as you are. They're probably they're watching me like a hawk as well. They think I'm the vanguard of an advancing force.
I mean, isn't that usually what hobgoblins do?
Not those that have left their people behind, that is.
I have no people. They all died. So, you know, hey. Can you take me with you? I don't want to be in this hole.
I'll do what I can, but I can't bring you with me right now. Raazu goes to move him into the cellar.
Birdie's like, no, don't throw me in the hole!
Raazu throws him in the hole.
And there's a loud splash.
So he closes the hatch, puts the wooden board back over the top.
Birdie immediately climbs out and starts beating on the thing.
Raazu,
unkind things.
As you do this, you're thinking, this is probably the meanest thing I'll ever do to this kobold. What do you explain to the soldier standing on the outside? About when they ask how it went, when they can expect to see kobolds from their watchtowers, why is he such a strange color?
He's insistent that he is not part of the dragon hordes to the north, but his bloodline originates somewhere to the southeast, in some of the swamps in that area. Which, given what I know about the dragon hordes, kind of tracks. I would think that creatures of the red dragon to the north would be more red in coloration instead of black. More black like what he is.
So he's really not one of the Tensalts kobolds?
I don't think so.
But we just heard a loud splash.
I didn't want to let him go until I got your okay.
Well, you didn't have to throw him back in the cellar if he's not here as an advance for kobold invasion. One of them muscles past you and opens up the cellar door.
Birdie immediately bolts out past him. Like a stray cat.
And this time the soldiers don't stand in your way. Raazu, they seem very convinced, and you're starting to get the sense that maybe these halflings are over-trusting. They let a hobgoblin march into the town armed. They take her word that this kobold is of no danger, and they don't stand in the way as the kobold darts out of the cellar out into the town.
Okay.
I mean, Birdie's gone.
Raazu will say to the others, I'll do my best to keep an eye out on him at the very least, if that's what you want.
Are these bushes actually here? Because if they are, I'm hiding in them.
They are, but if Birdie's going out here, he's in waist-deep water.
Oh.
A few steps off this path. I mean, the wooden path here represents where the ground is most dry, which in this situation just means very sticky mud. A few steps away, and you're starting to wade out into water. In fact, looking behind you over here, you see a couple of these halfling women wading out into what is chest-deep water for you guys. And kind of strangely, they just kind of take a bucket and lower it into the water, and you realize that this is where their village well is, that is now completely submerged. Just kind of forming this little pond in the center of town. Birdie, where are you going?
I don't really know where I'm at, and I'm assuming they took all my stuff from me.
No, it was all in that room.
Oh, okay. Well, I grabbed my stuff, and then I'm like...
You have your trusty shovel. That is the defining characteristic of your character.
For a kobold, it's more like a trowel.
Raza will tell the others, will tell the halflings that if you wish, I can keep an eye on him at the very least.
That's fair enough. Raza, make a perception check versus Birdie's stealth check.
Oh, okay.
This will just be for kind of the rest of the day.
Well, I rolled very poorly, so...
If only it was a strength check.
Birdie hates being wet.
Perception.
Yeah, you beat me.
About 11,
yeah.
Okay, and here's what happens over the course of the next couple hours. His word kind of gets around that the kobold probably isn't one of the red dragon kobolds, the ten salts kobolds from the mountains in the north, and nobody in the town has seen a black and brown scaled kobold before. But some of the old legends say that this type of dragonling hails from swamps and marshlands. And so, Birdie, you become approached throughout the rest of the afternoon by people asking a lot of questions. If you grew up in a swamp, how do you grow potatoes deep in a swamp if the land's not good for potatoes? Or how do you graze sheep? They're kind of asking you questions that don't have answers, because anybody who lives in a swamp wouldn't be doing these things.
That's what I'll tell them. I'll be like, you don't. Like, you could probably grow potatoes in a swamp. I don't know much about growing potatoes. Don't they just grow underground?
Well, that's the problem, they tell you, is all of our underground is underwater.
Like, have you ever thought about bringing the ground above water? Like, I don't know, digging some holes and then filling planters? Like, barrels?
All of their... Making planters, no. But all of their efforts to... try to shore up certain areas of the town, like making these walkways, is even a losing battle. Anytime they dig a hole, it begins filling up. They've actually had to stack excess stones around the edge of their well, and even that was for naught. But this planter's idea, they want you to show them what you mean.
Do you have a barrel?
They have casks for rainwater.
Okay. Well, they're Birdie will...
all full of rainwater at the moment.
Oh. Well, I mean, obviously that needs to go away. Birdie will just push one of them over, or try to. Well, these are halfling casks, right? I could probably push one of those over.
Halfling cask is the same size as a human cask.
Oh.
Clearly you know very little about halflings.
Do you need a hand, little tunneler?
Yes. Push this. Dump it out.
So let's get some, late afternoon actions. Windy, are you going to eventually break away from these people doing their star signs, or are you going to spend the whole rest of the afternoon doing this?
Did I get the news that Birdie has left the hole?
News travels very quickly in this town, and yeah, eventually you do see a kobold and this 7-foot-tall hobgoblin rolling a couple of barrels out towards the tree line with a couple of these halfling villages, farmer men with straw hats in tow.
Actually, once Wendy sees that like in here that Birdie's going to go teach farming, Wendy would probably break off and go check on that, because if she's giving bad farming advice, she wants to know about it now.
Okay. What is Red going to do for the remainder of the afternoon?
Well, I was informed there was beer and food here, so Red is going to look into getting some of that.
Okay.
He's been out in the wilderness way longer than he's comfortable with.
Yeah, and you're directed to the same kind of commons area.
Uh-huh.
Where the village elder meets you. And as you enter, before we get into that, what is Adrex doing for the remainder of the afternoon?
Exact same thing.
Beer going into the commons?
And food. Beer and food.
Adrex.
Did you ever come up with a question?
And food. Oh, yeah, Adrex did come up with a question. Is Adrex going to have a really good meal tonight?
Yes.
Yes!
you just shake the Aarakocra and then wait for the magic 8-ball triangle to come up?
Adrex.
All signs point to yes.
Yeah.
Coming into the commons, you get the same kind of spiel that Raazu does. And this old elder and the other workers in the house looks surprised, but also relieved at just the kismet at how much muscle has just walked into their village on a day when they so desperately need it. And yeah, they put you to work to help bail out this basement, this cellar. So they want you to go down and dredge out water, and they're just trying to slosh it out one of the back windows of the house. They've got the cellar windows completely boarded up, although they are still leaking down there. And looking down at this work, they've got kind of a bucket line going. And even with your help, you can tell this is a losing battle. Red, you are not directed to the bucket line. Instead, the Elder wants you to sit in a nearby chair. Okay. And go ahead and make a disguise roll. Let's see how well you're disguised versus his insight.
Looks like that's just a quick question.
What was that disguise roll?
It looks like that's just charisma.
Yeah.
That's a six.
A six, okay. Yeah, what's Adrix's question?
Is the water flowing in from a different place where they're bailing it out?
It's seeping in. Each of these buildings looks like it has a large earthen cellar, and it's just seeping in through the earth. The earth is turning to muck and mud. They have wooden braces in the cellar, so the houses probably aren't in any danger of collapsing, but the walls themselves are not reinforced with much except just these wooden braces. So what's happening is the earth is getting so sodden that it's just leaking in through the actual basement. The basement window, the cellar window that would look out right at ground level is underwater. The water is just sloshing in through it, but they've affixed boards over it to try to hold it back.
Okay.
Red.
Mm-hmm.
His insight was pretty terrible. He gets a very long look at your face, and he asks you if you would please to lower your hood.
Okay.
And he tells you that, meaning no insult, sir, but he tells you that people in the village don't take very kindly to humans. And he asks you point blank what you know about the village, like what you've heard about this place. And when he does, he's studying your face very intently, but you can tell that he doesn't see through your disguise.
Can I get an insight on what he's thinking at this time? Like, what is he trying to, like, protect me from the village? Is he trying to protect the village from me or anything like that?
Well, let me ask you this. In your at Yuan-ti culture, what do you do with your deformed young?
Our deformed young? I mean, I believe those become... I'm pretty sure those are put in some sort of position of, like, somewhere in the hierarchy of Malisons and whatever. Like, there's definitely a place for them.
Everybody you've seen in this village has these kinds of physical deformities.
Mm-hmm.
And the way that he talks about humans and other Southlings up front, almost immediately you put together that some number of generations ago, something about their deformities became taboo and they were exiled and then had to resettle here. So they're very mistrustful of humans, especially, who used violence and coercion to force them north across the wall into goblin-infested lands. This is why they have no love at all for humans. All for Southlings, but humans specifically.
Oh, I'm also a Southern exile. And I'll say that in Southling.
Did Red always know Southling?
Yeah.
I thought he had learned that, like, over the campaign.
No, it was the float language that I didn't pick, but yeah, it was like...
Oh, right. Yeah. Okay.
Yeah, he learned it because he was a slaver at one point.
So what exactly do you say in Southling? You say that you're also an exile from the South?
Yeah. Yeah.
You see his eyes get real wide when you speak the tongue, and he looks around to see if anybody else heard it. And then he shushes you.
Mm-hmm.
And he responds. He's talking in common, but it's clear he understands Southling.
Yeah.
And he tells you you shouldn't use the old language here.
Fair enough. I'm not particularly fond of it these days either.
But he does absolutely seem to buy your story.
Okay.
And then he puts you to work dredging water out of the cellar.
Okay. Red isn't as strong as Raazu, so. And or Adrex. Adrex is the one who's dredging water.
And if you get the same sense that Adrex on looking into this cellar, like, this is a lost cause. Like, trying to bail out the cellar is not going to work until the water naturally recedes
Yeah, and... Red will watch people working for about a minute, and then it'll be like, the water's just coming back in as fast as you're bailing it out. When you bail it faster, it just returns faster. It's just filling the space you evacuate.
The Elder grimaces when he hears this, and he asks if you want to eat tonight or not.
Well, yes, but maybe there's a better way to deal with the flow of the water.
He tells you when you think of one, he's all ears, but until then, grab a bucket.
Okay. I got an idea. Everyone back up.
Oh, no.
You're calling them all up out of the cellar?
Yeah.
Okay, they come up the two or three halflings on this bucket line come up the stairs into the commons.
Yeah.
And Adrex lets loose his breath weapon on all of the soggy walls, trying to freeze it.
You're not going
to
hit all the soggy walls, because if you look at your handy-dandy stat block, you have a 15-foot cone.
Which I know.
You can probably get the entirety of one of these short walls down here.
That'll do.
So what's the intent here? To freeze as much of this water as you can?
Yeah, freeze the wall so it stops seeping in from... And then maybe start making progress.
Roll the damage on that.
Okay.
How successful this is going to be will be determined by how much damage you can do here.
I do get 2d6. How about that?
Right. The wall's going to fail with con save, because walls don't have constitution.
8.
Okay. And there's oohing and aahing from the top of the stairs as you unleash this dragon's breath. And when you're done and you inhale again, you hear... as they clap. Red, what's your reaction to the dragon breath?
Nothing. Red does his best to remain completely...
All right.
It's like dragon breath, whatever.
Non-faced.
That's what I had for breakfast this morning. This is going to help considerably, if only because now there's only water seeping in through one of the walls, and we'll say it's the one of the walls, or it's the wall that has the outside window that you've frozen into place. This will help in the short term, but it's in the middle of spring, so the ice is not going to stay frozen forever, maybe a day or two, and if the water doesn't recede, if the rains return, it's not going to be a long-term solution at all. But it does make your immediate task of bringing down the water level in this cellar quite a bit easier.
That'll do.
Raazu and Birdie.
Yeah.
As you two are heading out towards the outskirts of town, one of the halflings is asking Birdie a lot of questions about this planter idea that he had. And Wendy, are you running up behind them or are you flying to catch up with them?
I'll fly to catch up.
And you guys are swiftly joined by a bird lady with the most beautiful eyes you've ever seen in your life.
Really good. Second best eyes. They would only be improved if they had some fire in them.
So, hello? Birdie, do you actually have an idea, or are you trying to BS your way through this?
No, I mean, like... You ever seen that thing where they're like, yeah, you grow potatoes and you just put a bunch of potatoes, put like a few inches of dirt, put some potato, like...
I don't need the technical specs, I just wanted to know, is this a deception check, or is this actual knowledge that Birdie's going to impart?
Well, I mean, he would know how to, like, the kobolds would have had to eat.
Yeah, so, but kobolds are carnivores. Well, they're scavengers.
I mean, like, they would have grown, like... tubers and like, you know, roots and stuff like that.
Mushrooms.
Yeah, mushrooms.
Kobolds eat the parts of things that bigger monsters don't want. But okay, you've got actual knowledge that you're going to impart here.
Right.
And yeah, well, Wendy is here and seems interested.
And then Birdie just kind of stops in the middle of his explanation and then asks them if they, like, why they haven't built any levees.
You mean to keep the water up back?
Yeah.
They've attempted to, but the rains have just been too strong and too swift the whole season. any time they've done anything to try to keep the waters out has been... I mean, they don't have much here except earth and wood, and the deluge has been too much for their wooden barriers they put up. They've tried to dig earthen trenches to keep the water away from their fields and livestock and whatnot, but it just hasn't been enough. There's just not enough muscle power in town to do the labor that would be needed.
And this has never happened before?
No, it's been an incredibly wet season this spring. Hmm.
But at least this way you won't have to leave indoors, like, since all the indoors are all dry. You can just keep the potatoes there and grow them in there. This is a really good idea.
Mm-hmm. And Barry's like, yeah, you just do a layer of dirt, then you cut the potatoes in half, you put them down, you do another layer of dirt, cut the potatoes in half, and he just, like, all the way to the top. And then when they're done growing, you just dump the barrel out.
They're like, of course, that's what Matt Damon did in that movie. And the idea seems sound enough, but you're talking to farmers that have done things a particular way for generations and have never been faced with having to think outside the box. The difficulty now is going to be finding the proper soil, because you obviously don't want to just fill a barrel with mud.
Nope.
And neither of them brought a shovel.
Well, I have good news. And Birdie pulls out his shovel.
Okay.
I have a shovel.
Cartoonish gleaming sound effect.
One of the halflings is sent back into town to retrieve some... Well, I guess they would have brought it with them to bring some potato scraps and things to layer in these barrels. And is this what the three of you spend the afternoon doing?
Yeah. Well, that's what I'm doing. So like, how far outside of the village does the flood extend? Can we just, like, go a little further out and find, like...
The village is in a... kind of a lowland area. Several hundred yards away from the village proper is a tree line in your direction where they would go and do their logging and whatnot. Often the other direction is where their fields were situated. The fields at this point, looking down into them, are entirely waterlogged. The reason their fields aren't on this area is because it's a much more hilly and forested area. A lot of terracing would have to be done.
Where are we in relation to the river? Because would it be practical to try and trench it all the way to the river?
Probably not. Just looking on the map here, I mean, you guys are probably a good day from the river over here to the south, and probably is that same distance from the smaller tributary.
Okay.
The reason that their village is built so far away from the river is because... goblins use the river to travel. And keeping away from those goblin raiders, or in the manner of the larger river coming down from the mountain, orc raiders from the other side of the river, who are known to be much more violent. Goblins and their hordes tend to take what they want and then go, whereas an orc, they'll raise the entire village, enslave anybody they don't kill, and then leave the village entirely in ruins. So, I mean, the labor force that would be required to dredge the river would be supernatural in size. Let's get... Birdie, are you trained in nature? It's on your stat block.
Yes.
Go ahead and make that check.
I was reading what I
was doing. Go ahead and make a nature check, and let's get a strength check from Raazu and Windy. I'm assuming that Birdie's not doing a lot of the physical labor here. He's kind of taking care of the technical stuff, and that Windy and Raazu are doing most of the actual heavy lifting.
It's a 21.
After Windy explains it, she's going to ask the villagers if they need any help shoring up their walls. Like, I'm assuming that, like, the water has kind of cracked it to allow it to seep in a little bit. But, I mean, you can keep most of that out, no problem.
The structures are built of wood and stone. And most of the larger structures have earthen cellars that are shored up by wooden logs. So probably none of the structures are in danger of collapsing. But if the water level gets any higher, the bottom floors of their houses will start to flood.
What do you mean? You just... You put on the... How do you... What's the word?
The... They whistle back at you.
The white, like the white stuff, there's some of it like a day north of here. It's in a big pit.
What are you talking
anyways,
about?
Anyways, you burn it. You burn it real hot, and then the water makes it stop going through the walls.
Yeah, they don't have any idea.
Wendy just looks extremely frustrated that she doesn't know the correct word.
Yeah, I don't know what you're talking about either.
No.
Raazu, you're extremely frustrated because you're trying to do this work with a halfling-sized shovel.
Mm-hmm. But that's a I did roll a 19 on that.
Okay. They ask you if you'd be willing to go find some of this material if you think it'll help.
I mean, yeah, absolutely. Or you can use like clay. You can use clay. That's not the white stuff, but you can use that too. Do you have any of that? You have this river nearby.
The river's about a day away, or half a day's. Well, half a day's walk for them. They're halflings. You'd be there back much quicker.
All right, I'll just go get the chalk. Don't worry.
Okay.
Chalk.
So all of you put in a hard day's work. As the sun begins setting, Raazu and Birdie, you're rolling these barrels of potatoes back into town. Because nobody is sure that whether this will work or not, the plan right now is to store these in the storeroom area here, with kind mm-hmm. of, which is supposed to be for their winter stores that they've already had to begin to deplete. Which is already still depleted from winter. Their harvests just have been very lackluster because of the rains. And meanwhile, you guys in the cellar, in the commons, have done pretty good work dredging out as much of the water as possible. And Windy, the sun is already completely set by the time you've returned to the village, and you can see the lights of mostly cook fires around the village. And so your plan you're going to put into action the next day.
Uh-huh.
Much of the people in town are very impressed at the labors of these five travelers that have shown up on their doorstep. And what they're going to do tonight is kind of have a meager but very well-intentioned feast. Just kind of makeshift in the commons where everybody, all the families of the town, are going to bring a dish to make sure that your bellies are well-fed, that you enjoy mead and song, and have a good night's rest before the day's labors tomorrow. And that's the scene you arrive back to, Windy, when you come back with your big bag of chalk.
Why would we need more than one dish? We just put the meat on the dish. You only need one.
Well, you're not very interested in cooking, are you, Windy?
What's that? You hunt something and then you eat it.
Hunting in this area, you can tell they don't do a lot of like game hunting. Mostly what they do is raise livestock, some of which has been lost to the flood, some of which has had to been moved to higher ground for grazing. Mm-hmm. And the difficulty here is that the people tending the stock has had to move further afield during the day, which is potentially dangerous if they're out of sight of the town's watchtowers.
Have I seen all the snakes in the waters here at all?
Make a perception check.
Be a 20.
You have not, and that's very strange, because aside from like the ponds and lakes and little bodies of water that you've past
mm-hmm.
on your journey here, this is easily the most sodden patch of earth that you've seen, this particular village in this location. The standing water outside, especially in the area around the well, and especially mm-hmm. in the cellar that you've been working in all day, this is the kind of place you would expect those snakes to congregate, but you have not seen them in the village borders.
So yeah, during the, once we're eating, I'll just kind of turn next to Adrex. I'll be like, hey, Adrex, did you see any snakes on your way here? Aquatic snakes, specifically.
Adrex, are you trained in nature or survival?
Yeah.
Which one?
Nature.
I've
been trained in both.
Okay. You have, and it didn't strike you as odd until now, because you didn't follow a river to get here, and you would not typically see aquatic snakes this far away from a body of water. But come to think of it, in the past day or two, yeah, you did catch sight of the kind of snakes that Red is describing.
Well, yeah, now that you mention it,
There are none here. I'm not much of an outdoorsman, but I did notice an unusual number of them on the way.
Huh. Maybe they got lost.
The snakes got lost.
Yeah.
In the part of the world that has the unnatural amount of water, the aquatic snakes on their way here got lost.
Yeah. Doesn't sound that strange.
I want each of you, when I say your name, to tell me how many drunk points you want on between 0 and 3, starting with Raazu.
Probably 1.
Okay. Birdie, they are very, very interested to see how much beer you can handle.
Raazu was a teetotaler back in his day.
So, Birdie, how many drunk points do you want?
3. Yes.
How many actual drinks does this represent?
1.
So he has 1 mug of halfling beer and he's done. That's it. Wendy.
2.
Red.
0. Red is immune to poison.
Immune. Oh, that's right. Adrex.
3.
Halflings.
He'll drink as much as Adrex, but.
The drink isn't fancy. I mean, it's not hard spirit. It's not fruity like wine. It's just a good heart. It's like a meal in a glass. It's what they're serving up. The actual meal is fairly meager, but it's very clear that all of the families in town are showing their generosity as much as they can. None of these people are much to look at. They all have bizarre growths and colorations and weird spots of hair. And some of them, their eyes don't sit right in their heads. And some of them have big, terrible teeth. And some of their extremities are bent in strange directions, or they walk with an unnerving gait. But it's clear that as guests of their village who have all come and immediately pitched in to help in their time of need, they intend to make sure that your bellies are as full as they can make them, that everybody has their fill of drink, and there's no shortage of merriment and song. And then the earthquake strikes. So that's where we're going to take a 15-minute break.